Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Zara Kassim. I'm the head of South Africa, so I look after CIMA in South Africa. It's my pleasure tonight to welcome you to the CIMA 2015 syllabus update. I think by now, you'd have been inundated with emails and communication from CIMA telling you about the syllabus update and extensive research that's gone into the last 4 or 5 years in order to ensure that the syllabus will be relevant to employers in the employer market. So tonight, we are delighted to have Peter Stewart with us, who is the Director of Learning at CIMA, and who has all the answers. So please feel free to ask all the questions. So that means is that Peter is basically responsible to ensure that the CIMA students have access to all the support that they need throughout their studies. Peter joined CIMA in 2013, which was really partway through the project where we were delivering the 2015 syllabus and assessment. But I think, unfortunately for him, he found himself in the thick of things. So that is all the real hard work was being done. His previous experience includes 20 years as a CIMA tutor, including 10 years as director of the largest CIMA course program in the world. So I think you will agree with me that he's the right man with the right credentials to give you all the right answers to that. All right, Peter, over to you. No pressure.
No pressure at all. Thank you. Thank you. That's a lot of fun. When Zara said there, I've got all the answers, then that probably means that I should know all the questions, and you'll probably just want me to list out the answers to all the exams for the next 5 years. But I think you can allow a little bit of leeway in that and say that I've got lots of answers to the questions that you might be thinking about where things are just now in your studies and what the 2015 syllabus will hold for you when it kicks in, obviously next year. My role is, as Zara said, is particularly to do with aiding the students through the journey towards the exams. I'm not the one who's responsible for having written the syllabus, and I'm not the one who's responsible for creating the exams, although I do like to think I've got an enormous amount of influence, because anything that they do put through the syllabus project, basically I complain about if I don't like it and if I don't think it's going to be a fair assessment, if it's not going to be fair on you guys. As Zara said, I spent 20 years as a tutor, and we had lunch today with the guys at UNISA, and one of them reminded me that the first time he'd met me was at a CIMA lecturers conference in Cambridge, England, in 1993. And he remembers me because I was the one that was giving the examiners then such a hard time for creating questions which didn't reflect the wording of the syllabus and they weren't fairly worded and so on. So he and a whole load of other former colleagues in the world of exam training look at my role now and say, you are the poacher turned gamekeeper. I'm the one now who's on the inside listening to what students and to what lecturers are saying and trying to feed that into the system so that what comes out is really, really fair. Not just for you, not just for the lecturers, but as Zara mentioned, you know, what we're doing with this qualification is creating something which is helpful to employers so that when you come through as a qualified management accountant, an employer can look and say, well, that's what this individual is capable of doing. So I'm able to recruit at this level somebody who's got that qualification. So it's a very, very important thing that we're doing with this syllabus. I mentioned, you know, 1993, that's quite some time ago. I think it's about 5 CIMA syllabus changes that I've been involved in, all from the outside except this one. And in most of the cases, it was driven by, you know, sort of academic observations and so on, rather than speaking to the employers and turning the whole thing into this, making you guys ready for business. So I'm quite excited that that's what's happened with this one. I think it's a really, really good move that's been made over the last few years. So what I'm going to do this evening is go through just a few of the principles. There's really there's three things really that I'll be looking at. One is just very, very quickly to make sure that we're all on the same page, going through the background of the syllabus change. What have we done between the current 2010 syllabus and the 2015 that we'll be launching, or we have launched but we'll be examining next year. Then I'm going to spend a bit of time looking at the assessments themselves, what we're doing in terms of making sure that we can certify people as being competent for the employers. And then lastly, the third thing that I'll look at is the position that you all find yourselves in. Right, what am I doing now? What happens to me at the turn of the year? So the transition from the 2010 to the 2015. And a lot of this has been in, well, probably all of it, most of it anyway, has been in the communications that you've had by email. But I just think it's useful for people to be able to ask questions about their position, about the principles, things they haven't quite understood from the printed word. And bits that they hadn't seen and so on. So, you know, apologies if it is repetitive and you've read through everything absolutely thoroughly. But I do think it'll be useful to make sure that we're all on the same page. So, you know, as I've said already, you know, the mission of CIMA is to help people and businesses to succeed. The people are yourselves, launching on a career with a designation that will take you through promotion after promotion, exciting jobs, helping businesses to succeed. The businesses, you know, again, they're the ones that are going to say at the end, we've got a vacancy, we need someone who can drive forward the business, who can help making decisions, who understands all the way that the numbers work, understands how people work together to make a business successful. So that's formed the basis of what we're looking at. We've gone through this process where we spoke to employers first. As I said, that was instead of going to the academics and asking what the latest thinking is in terms of management accounting and business management. We've gone to the employers and we said, what do you need from your finance professionals? And they've given us all sorts of answers, you know, and of course they want tax advice, and of course they want audit, internal audit, and of course they want people who will write the financial statements. And, you know, we've looked at that and said, you know, that's fine. There are accounting bodies and tax qualifications that deal with that, but we're the management accountants. So we've picked out from the responses what we see the management accountants as providing. Okay. We've developed, and you'll hear this mentioned an awful lot, you'll have seen it in some of the communications that have come out, a competency framework. All right, so a competency framework covers not just the qualification through to, you know, strategic level and so on. It covers the practical experience requirements that you'll have to follow when they kick in 2015. And it also covers the lifelong learning, the professional development framework. So there's a slide on that just to touch on what happens in there. The exams and assessments, of course, you've heard a lot about those. And you know that we're working with the largest computer-based exam testing company in the world, Pearson VUE, which has delivered exams for all sorts of professions, the medical profession, the legal profession, and lots of practical exams as well. So we work very, very closely with them to say, how can we ensure that somebody doing the exams is competent in the learning outcomes that are in the syllabus? Okay, and then we have, we've not ignored the tuition providers. We've gone out and spoken to them about what's practical, how can things be delivered. They've been working with us very, very closely, at least for the last year. I joined CIMA in May, I think it was, last year. And very quickly, you know, my responsibility is look after the tuition providers, the tuition providers saying what's happening with the syllabus. So I and my team have worked to bring the tuition providers into the fold to make sure that their voices are heard. And, you know, we've worked with them very closely, I say, I think really closely since about September. To make sure that as students, you're able to get the support that you need when you move into the 2015 qualification. Okay? And as I said at the start, the overall idea is that employers have got a clear picture of what a CIMA person is. So they know what type of person they're looking for, and they want that type of person because their qualification has been designed to drive businesses forwards. Yeah? And the students then come to CIMA because they're saying there's a connection there to employability. And we've got this phrase, you won't see it too clearly from further back, but we look at competent and confidence throughout what we're doing. And this is, actually comes back when we're talking about the assessment. There's competence, there's being able to do something. Right? And that's fine. We can be competent about something, but if we don't have the bravery to say that this is what needs to be done, or I'm going to do this because it's best for our business, then nothing gets done. All right, so we like have the seats more over here, don't worry. We like the idea of combining the two things together to say that not only do you demonstrate that you know stuff, but you're confident enough to be able to apply it, all right? I always think, you know, the idea of somebody being confident yet not competent, that's frightening, isn't it? You know, imagine that in the medical profession particularly. Well, I'll have a go. Open heart surgery, I've seen that on ER. I'm going to have a go. I've got a friend who built an extension to his house because he needed it done, but he had seen it being done on a soap opera and on the television. And genuinely, he said, oh, well, if they can do that, then I can do it. He is a chartered accountant, and the house is still standing. He's not in it anymore. But so yes, he must have had a modicum of competence, but that hadn't been assessed and proved, and his confidence just absolutely frightening. Anyway, that's what the reason that the assessment is the way it is that it does combine those two phrases together. So we'll try and link back to that when I'm looking at the assessment. Okay, the management accounting competencies. Again, you'll see me refer back to these in a while. Core accounting finance skills, you know, all the employers saying, well, you know, people need to understand that debits go on the left and credits go on the right and what a provision is, and they need to be able to calculate variances and so forth and so on. So there's certain things that you need to develop throughout your qualification. Business acumen. A lot of exam questions, not so much from CIMA, but from other accounting bodies in my experience, really don't touch on this. They don't say so what? You've calculated variances, well done. Now, so what? What does it mean? You need that. When you're in a business, you don't just hand over a report and say, there's the variances, see you next week. Yeah? You go over and say, look, there's a couple in here that I'm concerned about, because the nature of our business means that if we don't sort out that problem, then competitors will get into the market or customers will be dissatisfied with our product or the service that we're offering. So we've got to put things into a business context and say so what? This is why we're doing this. Third way, coming around the wheel, to people skills. Again, we've got to be able to say to people, right, here's the answer, and actually, I'm pointing the finger at you for this. Or, I need your support. I need to buy you in to come with me on this and make sure that we can make that thing right. And again, that's where we're getting up to the higher levels of the qualification and moving further through an organisation so that we are becoming business leaders. And this is what we want to do with the CIMA qualification, is we want to produce people who are potential business leaders of the future. So we've got to put things together that can demonstrate that and can prepare you just to think about what you might be doing, rather than just saying, I can calculate that, I can make a balance sheet balance, right? Underpinning the whole thing, we've got the professional standards, if you like, the ethics, the integrity and professionalism. All right, so knowing what the right thing is to do and demonstrating that we can do the right thing in circumstances. So again, that comes through in the way that we'll be examining things in, from 2015. It's already in there. Anyone who's had a look at the strategic level exams or the T4B case study will know that scenarios are set with ethical issues in there. You know, there's not a direct question that says, what's the correct thing to do ethically here? But there are problems, there are issues that need to be addressed. So we're putting that through the qualification. Now, here's a qualification that we've got just now, the 2010 syllabus. As you are no doubt aware, we have got one, two, three, four, go back. Made them all disappear. Wrong direction. I go up with the wheel. There we go. We've got nine subjects, nine syllabuses, 3-hour exams for each of them on paper twice a year. And we top it all with the part B of T4, the case study. So 10 3-hour exams, all written on paper. T4 part B doesn't have a syllabus. It just sees how we put things together for a big sort of business role play context scenario thing. Okay. Now, you know, there's not a tremendous amount that is wrong with that syllabus. There's very little at all that's out of date or peculiar. The one thing that I've always found unusual is paper F2. It's not my... So I'm a P1, P2, F3 tutor. And financial management involves finding the source of finance, making sure that it's deployed effectively and checking the effectiveness of that. Paper F2 isn't about that, it's about financial reporting. So the columns and the rows have got their names really just for cosmetic reasons. You know, it's an enterprise pillar. It's like playing battleships, yeah? I'm in E3, miss. P2, yeah, and so on. And I said, there's nothing, absolutely nothing wrong about that. However, there's one or two things about the content of the syllabus that employers said, we need our management accountants to be displaying more aptitude or greater competence in some areas that aren't really reflected in here. I'll mention those in a second. So as far as the syllabus itself goes, say this was my thing. F5, what happens when you hit the F5 key? Refresh. Yeah? So it's not a new syllabus, because that would imply that we've taken the old one completely apart and we've brought in something that's completely different. This is a refreshed syllabus. What? I don't know what's going on with the animation. I had fun creating it and I can't remember what it does. Anyway. So yeah, what you're looking at has got nine subjects, nine syllabuses, no more, no less. The overall weight of content in the 2015 syllabus is the same. There's the same number of things that you have to learn about and practice with and be able to do. Yeah? So we've got nine subjects. And the nine subjects, you know, as I said, you know, not a tremendous amount wrong with having an enterprise talking about, you know, the overall strategy of the business, the direction that it wants to head. Assessing performance and being able to make decisions about what we do to try to achieve that aim. And then finally, showing the outside world that either we've got a great plan and can you give us some money so we can carry out that plan, or saying to them, thanks for the money that you gave us to support this plan. Look what we've done. Here's all the profit we've made and the net assets we've generated and so on. So that's the story from left to right. It's the same thing. It's overall business ideas, decisions and reporting. And going up, as I'll show you in a second, to do with the competencies, operational management, strategic. Sensible to have three areas in there that help you progress through. Now, obviously I'll talk a little bit more about the examination of these. But to put it into simple-ish terms just now, Each level now has got a case study exam. And the reason for doing this is that when you do E1, we're basically giving you the toolkit of E at that level. We're saying this is the stuff you need to know about. This is the stuff that you might, well, maybe not so much in E1, but definitely in P and F. These are the techniques you need to be able to apply. All right? But what we're going to do there is really just test them as, could you use that toolkit? Could you use this? Could you use that? So it's very much the competence part. Can you make it all work? Right? So we're not testing the subjects at a super high level. We're just going to have the, can you do the calculation? Do you have the correct definition? Can you tell the difference between two concepts that are mentioned in there? And make sure that you do understand those things. All right? So we do that one by one and all the way up there. So now that you've got the enterprise toolkit for operational, the performance and the financial toolkit, right? We think it's safe to send you out into the world as an operational level management accountant. So what we're going to do to send you out into the world, and the diagram doesn't make a big enough case of this in my view, but I'm not a graphic designer, so I better shut up. But the operational case study exam is a sort of role play. Yeah, it's a business role play. It's going to sit you down and say, pretend you're in the office and a colleague, your supervisor, or somebody who works below you, especially when you get up to the strategic level, is going to come in and say, something's gone on to do with our business. Here's a news report, or I've received an email from a supplier, or I was at a presentation and somebody was talking about manufacturing techniques, or something's happened. And it's made me think I need some advice. Okay? So, can you give me that advice? And it doesn't say that advice must be based upon variance analysis or financial accounting ratios or various different management theories and, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs or whatever's in E1. It doesn't say that. It's really testing. Do you know which of your toolboxes to go to give good advice? And it may be that you dip into the P toolbox and a bit into the E toolbox, which is why you'll have seen some communications referring to these as the integrated case studies. Because it's not testing your knowledge of the syllabus topics in detail. It's testing how you're able to use that in the business scenario. So, you know, you're going to be asked in P1, there'll be questions that say, can you calculate this variance, that variance, this ratio, this stuff that is in the syllabus? The case study is never going to say, prepare a statement of variances, reconciling original budget to actual profit. Because we'd already tested that you were competent to do that when you did the objective test exam. Okay? Now, same story obviously up at management and strategic. just very quickly, I mean, I'll just chuck the words up on the screen because there's not a tremendous amount to this, but the research that we had with employers looked at the 2010 syllabus, and these were the only areas where they sort of gave us a bit of a wish list. Big data and predictive analysis. You know, the sort of stuff that when you buy something on Amazon, and then it says, oh, people who bought this also bought some of these. You know, that's big data, yeah? Very effective way just to analyze what your customers are doing. It can be used in for suppliers, it can be used for employees and so on. All right? So that's something that is a huge part of decision making and the opportunity to grow your business. So the employers that we've spoken to have said, We think that's a role for management. Can't think anyone else in an organisation who would do it. It's not the tax advisor. It's not the financial reporting guy. It's not IT. Yeah? Finance function transformation is to do with the outsourcing of the finance function, or the shared services idea, and just the fact that the finance department for a company isn't doing what it would have done 15 years ago. So to understand how we've got different relations between the business and the finance function, again, we were asked to address that with the syllabus. Sustainability has been with us, maybe not specifically in the syllabus to date, but in doing scenario-based questions at strategic and at the T4B level, addressing sustainability is a surefire way to pick up good marks, because you've got to be aware of business developments, you've got to be aware of current issues, and sustainability is one of them. Integrated reporting is just it's another development in the financial pillar to do with how we speak to the outside world. Do we just give them barefaced numbers, or do we look at something that integrates more with our management accounting function? So those are sort of newer topics. The last three on this list, obviously costing. A few years back, I don't know how many long, we were the Cost and Works Accountants, Institute of Cost and Works Accountants. Nothing's changed. This is just sort of a seal of affirmation from employers that costing is critical to what they expect from management accountings, understanding costing. Ethics came out very, very strongly, and as showed you in the competency framework, that underpins a whole lot. And they did ask us to retain an element of taxation, the impact of taxation, in the syllabus. And again, I'll just say it one more time, we are not going to be tax specialists, we're not going to be tax advisors. We just simply need to know that, if you make a profit of 100 when your tax rate is 30, then you're going to have 30%, you're going to be left with 70 afterwards. That's about the extent of my tax knowledge. I was very nearly top of the class when I did my tax exam. The person who went on to be the leader of BPP's tax courses was in the same class as me when we were doing our exams, and I beat her in every single class exam. But now, that's about the extent where we are just now. All right, so we need to know that there is an impact of certain decisions on tax. If we want detailed stuff, then we'll go off and find somebody who's studied with a Chartered Institute of Tax or something along those lines. Okay, now, I mentioned about the levels and the competencies. So the donut here, as we like to call it unofficially, this isn't a proper CIMA term, but the competency donut at each level is saying, what do we expect someone completing that level to look like? All right, so at operational level, this is where you would be at in our sort of hypothetical career, that our role play career. You'd be what we call a finance officer, so not senior, but you would be having to talk to product owners, you'd have to talk to managers, you'd have to implement their plans, you'd have to execute the plans, but you'd generally be looking at things in the short term. All right, so feeding back on performance in the short term, not driving big strategic plans, that comes later. All right, so a lot of what you're doing is based upon the technical skills. 64% of the operational level is technical skills. In a business context, because it just can't be divorced from business context, but very little to do with definitely leadership skills, because you're the guy being led, and you still have to have people skills. You have to be able to communicate properly to the person who's asked you for a task. For instance, if you have a finance director who asks you to comment on a short-term finance decision, you don't want to start off by saying, oh, dear finance director, I've based this decision on relevant costs. A relevant cost is a future cash flow which arises or doesn't arise as a result. How did he get to be, if he got to be finance director without knowing that, right? Well, you're probably working for the wrong company, yeah? So anyway, so we it's still important that we think about communication and so on. At the management level, we've gained a promotion. Right? We're now doing work that will go up to the chief finance officer. And we'll be working with senior management. We'll be looking more or further into the future, longer term decisions and longer term performance and implications. And our role will be more than just putting together the figures that help make the decision. We'll be monitoring what other people are doing. We'll be monitoring other people who are making those decisions. So therefore, there's much more of the weighting goes towards the leadership and the people skills. Business acumen grows slightly from what it was, and there's less of a reliance on the technical skills. All right. Now, that's not to say there are fewer technical skills that you have to know at the management level. The objective test questions will test quite a lot of the technical skills. There's a lot that you have to learn about. Okay. But when we're looking at the case study that rounds off the level, there'll be much more on the business context and who's involved in things and how we're going to drive these ideas forward. Up until the strategic level, where we're looking at, now notice this, you are not at strategic level the chief finance officer, right? Assuming that we're looking at a large-ish organisation. Chief finance officer has qualified CIMA and has spent a few years with professional development and with business experience getting to where the chief finance officer is. Okay? But we're operating at strategic level very closely with the chief finance officer and the senior management team. We're involved in strategic decisions, long-term strategic decisions. Okay? And again, when you're making those decisions, you have to rely on the fact that somebody's fed information up to you, which is technically reliable. Yeah, chief finance officer is not going to be sitting down thinking, hang on, if the debit is for fixed assets, then the credit must be suspense account, yeah? That's always a suspense account. Probably would be what a chief finance officer does, is put it in the suspense account and let one of the operational level guys sort it out. All right? So anyway, in coming to the structure of the syllabus, we've created these personas, if you like, so that when you're doing the case studies at each level, you've got to say, well, this is who I am. This is who I'm speaking with. I'm not going to be talking about debits and credits in minute detail when I'm doing a strategic decision. I'm talking about the product, the place, the people, yeah? All of that stuff. So that's an important part to realise because it has framed what we've done. So the first thing about the syllabus, just practical things about you doing exams. Because we've made these levels so very distinct from one another with those competency donuts, we've put the syllabus back into levels. I say back into, it's been a long time since we had four stages, it was, when we last asked people to complete a level before moving on to the next one. All right, so when I was shouting at that conference in 1993, we had four stages of four papers. You couldn't do stage two unless you'd passed your four papers. You had to sit four papers together. You had to pass all four papers. Oh, those were the days gone by. I'll tell you about that another time. I'll give you a history story. But we are asking you to complete each length. So you can't go on and start making management decisions and give management advice unless you've proved yourself to be confident and competent at the operational level. So to go through the operational level, you're going to take the three subjects, E1, P1, F1. You don't have to do it in that order. You can do it in what order you choose. And the order you choose, it could be based on alphabetical order. It could be based on... wasn't the best way to start, was it? It could just be based on whatever's available if you're studying through a local college that's running. You know, if you go along tomorrow and say, what have you got on? They say, we start E1 in 2 weeks' time. Then E1. There's no reason why it has to be E1, then P1, then F1. Okay? The tests, and I'll go in a little bit more about the objective testing as a means of assessment, but these will be, each of those three subjects at each level is going to be tested using a 90-minute online test using objective testing. Very careful to say objective testing, not just multiple choice. Another point I'll come back to. And you know, because we're not using exam halls, we're using our partners Pearson View, who have got test centres all over the place. We've gone up from when we started doing computer-based assessment for the certificate level. I think there was something about 250. Test centres that we were using. There's over 5,000 around the world. That's shortly going to go up to 6,000 around the world. And it will be on... I'll explain on-demand better than just being on-demand. You need to book before... You can't just walk in off the street and say, I fancy doing an E1 test. It's not far short of that, though. You just need to say, you know, is there a desk available? I'll be along there tomorrow. I think we're asking for 48 hours just to be reasonable. That'll be communicated nearer the time more accurately. But you know, it's when you want. If your test centre, local test centre, is open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, then yeah, you can do your test whenever. Some of the test centres operate like that. Some of them may be open 16 hours. They're open 7 days a week. You know, so there's great flexibility. So it's maybe not on demand, but it's when you feel ready to do it. All right? Once you've done your three and passed your three objective tests of the subjects, then we go through to the integrated case study for that level. All right, that is also going to be on computer. So if we've got time, I'll show you what it looks like. We can't quite do on-demand there because it is written like the types of exams that we've got just now. Yeah, you'll get information before you do your case study about a company, fictitious company in an industry. You'll have time to look at that industry, find out what the factors are, what the main cost drivers are, and so forth. So you can understand that business a bit. All right? And then we'll have four, we're calling them examining windows, and a window is simply five successive days. So in 1 week in February, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday of that week will be for operational level case studies. The following week, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, will be for management, and the week after that, Tuesday to Saturday, for the strategic level. So you can choose within that window, within those windows, when you take those exams. Not quite finalised, but it's very likely that those windows will be operational on the second week, management on the third, and strategic on the fourth week of each of those months. So nowhere near as much flexibility as the objective testing, but because we are, you know, we're doing it, it's like a written exam, we have to have some set times for that. Okay? So, once you've done that, so you've done your integrated case study, results will come back, and then you're able to move on to do the next level. Over again, three subjects, case study, three subjects, case study, and you're finished. Okay. Now, let's have a chat about pass marks. What's the pass mark for a 2015 objective test exam? 70%. Oh, you've read some of your pretties. There's it was probably in the smallest print, but you still saw it, yeah? Right. Okay, we like a 50% pass mark.
Yeah?
Do we? Okay. Here. Now, I think, here's just before doing this, something that our director of education always said when he was talking about pass marks and objective testing and competence. If you were about to get on an aircraft and you said to your pilot, "What did you get in your pilot's exam?" And he said, "Oh, I got 50%. What do you think? And he says, "Yeah, I'm really good at taking off. Could never handle the landing bit, right? But I got 50%. Likewise, your surgeon. You're saying, "Right, I'm just going to go for a bit of minor surgery here. What did you get in your exams?" 50%. I'm really good at cutting people open and taking bits out and looking at them. Can I get them back in the right order? Don't know how a needle and thread works. Bit of, super glue or something. You're not going to be too confident in there. So in general, we think that showing more than half marks is good, right? I think it's fair to say. And that's, again, you think about it with employers, you say, I'm going for a job as an accountant. I'm really good at debits, but every credit goes into the suspense account. That's how I do accounts, right? So let's just set this up as a scenario. 70%. I want people to be good at 70% of what they do. So I've set a syllabus that's got learning outcomes, and I'll be happy if you're good at 70% of them. Now, I'm setting you a paper-based exam, like we've got just now. So I say to an examiner, "Could you write me a 3-hour exam based on these learning outcomes?" Now, we've all done exams. Who's ever sat an exam thinking that a certain topic was going to come up? So you've worked really hard on, linear programming or regression analysis, yeah? And you get to the exam and you turn it over and what you wanted doesn't come up, yeah? It's because using paper in 3 hours, an examiner can't squeeze everything in to the exam. So somewhere between, and when you look at it, this is the genuine, between 65 and 75% of the learning outcomes is all that an examiner can test. And I know there are some things that are more likely to come up than others, but just run with that for a while, okay? So now, take the law of averages at this point. You've randomly become brilliant at 70% of the syllabus, and the examiner's randomly selected 70% of the syllabus and put that in. What's your score going to be? 49%. 70% of 70%, 49%. Okay? So when you get 50% in a paper-based exam, then by the law of averages, you're 70% competent. There you go. All trainee accountants, there's numbers. Never thought of that before. I'm going to turn it around on its head. I had a little bit of fun putting this lot together. Look at this. Come on, click, click, click. Right. So, let's take that. Same two things. Examiner's going to get 70% of the topics in. You've prepared 70% of what can be prepared, and you're really, really good at that 70%. Now, with a stroke of luck, the examiner's choice of topics exactly matches what you've tested. Yeah? And look at the score you got. 100%. You know that there's 30% of the syllabus you have never seen, but you've just got 100%. Yeah? That doesn't sound fair. You're not going to tell anyone, though, are you? Yeah? So 70 questions, or whatever it might be, 70 things tested, and there you're 70. However, yeah? Here's the other end. The examiner tested the 30 things you'd never touched and another 40. So you get the 40 right out of the 70 in the examiner's test. 40 out of 70 is 57%. Okay, by our standards just now, that's a pass. So you're relieved. But you think, hang on. He got 100% and he did the same amount of study as me. He's nearly got double my score. Yeah? So again, it's down to luck to an extent. Obviously, it only makes a couple of mistakes. Your 57% becomes 47. And all of a sudden, you know, you're retaking the paper. So for me, I don't want my exams to be based on luck. And in all those 20 years that Zara was talking about when I was teaching, you know, the most commonly asked question at the end of a revision course, what are your tips for the exam? Well, no, the question they did ask was, what about tips? And I would say, just leave them in this cup at the front of the room on your way out. I'm Scottish. Any revenue source is welcome. And somehow, you know, sometimes I would tip and it would just be, I'll guess five subjects because there's five questions. And I never even, yeah, you know, one course one week, the same course the next week. I couldn't remember what I'd tipped the week before, so students didn't get consistent. But they got consistent training how to pass exams. You get rubbish tips. Anyway, look, here's another weird scenario. Okay, let's find somebody. Now think of yourself as an employer for this example, right? Do you want to employ someone who can't be bothered to work on even half of the syllabus? No, because then you give them a task and they'll only do it half-hearted. So 45%, this person's only done 45% of the syllabus. But look, by the same logic, the examiner happens to set a question that's got 45 learning outcomes that this guy has done and 25 other learning outcomes that this guy has got no idea about. But that means that the guy's now got 55%. Is that right? 45 out of 70? I thought it would be a bit higher. Anyway, it's got a pass. Might have made a couple of mistakes, maybe. Yeah? But it's got a pass. So he's gone forward for an employment saying, I'm a qualified chartered management accountant. I got 55% in all my exams. This is super lucky. With that kind of luck, you'd be better doing the lottery than exams. But anyway, so there you are. You've got something that, to me, is unfair. If I've gone and done, you know, say 65% of the syllabus on the previous slide, and I've failed, I want to find this person in a dark alley. I make sure they don't get that job because they're trussed up and in a dustbin somewhere. Anyway, okay. And if justice were served, well, that's not even justice, is it? Because that says you got 25%. 25 out of 78. I don't know what's happened to my maths. Don't trust me. Look, the whole point is that these two individuals, we want the first one to get 70%. We want the second one to get 45%. And that's why we're introducing objective testing, because an objective test exam, because it's made up of these short questions that are, can't remember the exact right wording that won't get up your noses, but they're easier to answer than the long written ones. They've got, you know, fewer sort of twists and hidden things and you know, in the longer requirements, you've got to do this, then that, then discuss it and so on. So they're sort of compound questions. In the objective testing question, you get through them more quickly. So we can get through all of the component learning outcomes of the syllabus in 60 questions in 90 minutes. Yes?
Why not open book?
Why not open book? What would you have in an open book?
I mean, an open book exam.
Seriously,
yeah. Talking about reality, then if I want to answer something or if I need to know something, I just go onto Google to double check that my knowledge is right.
Yeah.
And then I'd apply to a situation. So why are we not open book examining? Because, it, I mean, especially at the higher levels, why not?
It's a remarkably good question that my colleague from education would have to answer. I'm not sure on that, and I think to get the efficiency of the examination out is one thing. But no, I do get your point that absolutely, if you're asked something about the how many P's are there in marketing now? Seven. Yeah, I mean, a list of seven P's, ridiculous idea. So yeah, I'd be straight on there thinking I can get five of them. What's the other two? Yeah, I suppose that's an ideal, and I wouldn't. Yeah, it's obviously not been incorporated just now. It's one that you know I'll take back and pursue because I wouldn't rule it out for future. I think what we try to do with the current ones, you know, there's the research bit that you do for the case studies, and you'll have. You know, so these mocked up articles and so on, so that the information that helps you to answer your question in the case study is available to you during the case study, just not worldwide open. But it's it would be interesting to see what happens in years to come, because I suppose that has to be the way that it goes. That has to be a future step. I mean, just the reason that I answered you, which books would you have, is that where I've seen open book exams in accountancy, they generally hinder the student rather than help, having the gaps and the tax, and because then people are, oh, I'd never seen that before. Nothing to do with the question that's being asked. That's so that's why I was asking then, and also I was just wondering management accounting. How many books would you need as reference? But your point is it very good in terms of some of those things that, you know, ultimately, yes, if I'm asked the seven P's, I'll Google it. I usually try to squeeze in an odd one, like psychology or P for Peter. Anyway, okay, so let me go back to the objective testing and we'll see what we can do with this. So, you know, when we're doing the objective testing, you know, comprehensive, I'm saying it's covering the all the learning outcomes. Rigorous, again, it's a way that an awful lot of professions have been testing. And it's moved on. You know, the types of questions, they're not just multiple choice. You know, so you can't get somebody who, with a stroke of luck, is going to guess B. I'm going back to some of my old teaching methods when we used to have objective testing. And the advice was always, if it's multiple choice and it's a number answer, guess B or C, because A and D being in ascending order, they're likely to have the biggest mistakes in them. So I've always advised that, and people noted it down carefully. It's moved on from that. We don't have things like that anymore. And by a process of default, if it didn't have numbers, you would choose A or D. So let's say we make sure that everything. So if you have studied a component learning outcome, there will be some questions on that. Depending on the weighting of the syllabus topic, you know, it will indicate how many questions there might be. The question types, we're going to have a sentence with some gaps in it, where your knowledge of the topic will say, right. It might be, some of it helps, you know, just in terms of how you know about sentence construction, but you can't, you know, you've got to choose between higher, lower, you've got to choose between certain definitions and so on, and drag them into the working. Now, you're not typing. This is one point. It's a list is given, you're dragging and dropping them in, or the sentence has got drop-down boxes partway through and you select one of four or five words in each of those. The only typing that you'll be doing to answer an objective test question is where it says, you know, what is 7 times 7? And there's a box there, and it asks you to type in the number 49. some of them, you'd be looking at regions and graph. You've got two variables. It might be to do with effectiveness of something and cost of something else, and think where on the graph a result might be. So you just click and a cross comes up saying what point you think it is. Multiple answer. Now, this is quite common in the exams now, and it for me, it's the toughest of the objective test questions, because it will say which items in the list apply. And there's a list of maybe seven things. It doesn't say which three items in the list apply. Some of them do, which three apply. So you don't know whether there's one, two, three, four, five, six, or seven items in the list that are being looked for. So for me, that's a really thorough test of somebody's understanding and knowledge of a topic. Okay? And there will be multiple choice questions, quite a lot of them, probably more at the operational level, fewer as we go up through the levels. Yeah? So we've got those, and it's, you know, quite a variety. And I will, in a moment, try to show you, you know, what they look like, or at least show you where you can find them to have a good look at them. When you've done your objective test, of course, there is only one right answer for each of the questions. So the computer knows straight away what you've done. What? Teacher technique, when the kiddies are laughing, you check that your flies are up. flies are up and you're laughing still. Bogies? No. Are we okay? All right, so look, you will get, you'll know straight away what your score is. And the feedback that we'll get is going to say within the syllabus areas, yeah, have you scored well? Well, I'll give you a score. I'll give a percentage score within each of the syllabus areas for the subject that you're doing. So that should you need to, well, two circumstances. Should you need to retake, you know which areas to work harder on. You could even, I mean, you could move on. This 70% doesn't have to be 70% in each of the syllabus areas. It's just a total of 70%. So it might come out and say you did 100% in area A and B and C, but you only did 40% in area D. And we would advise you then to take a look at the content of area and D and maybe just a little bit extra work before you go on to take the case study, just in case that becomes critical to you being able to answer the case study well and to move on to the next level. Okay, so what we don't include in the objective testing, so if we did only OTs, it would be over the top, OTs being OTT. So what we've not done in there is test things like the communication, the analysis of a complex situation. Yeah, you're testing your judgment, your ability to weigh up options and put forward a recommendation with justification. All right? And that's what the case studies are intended to do. So a lot of this stuff I've already said, so there you go. On a computer, 4 times a year, 5 days a week. Workday is in inverted commas because looking at the practice tests that are up there, some of them say, when you start the exam, here's a trigger, right? So the information that I mentioned, that's a news article. One of the practice exams is set in the airline industry, and the cost of jet fuel has been soaring. So the company's concerned about what it does, what its product mix is, and so on. So that's the trigger. There's some news, and your colleagues come in saying, what are we going to do? Then you've got a task. Right? Now, in the three levels, there's a different number of tasks. At operational levels, there'll be 4 or 5 tasks in the 3-hour exam. Okay? And after you've done the first task, it's like you sent an email off. Right? You're never going to touch that task again. It's gone. But then you get a follow-up trigger. And it says, so this is where the workday bit is in inverted commas, because in, I think it's the operational practice exam, it says a week later. So later on. So it simulates a work environment. So later, somebody else comes in with another issue and asks you to perform a task. And then somebody else, and then somebody else. So I say operational, that's 4 or 5. At strategic, it's 3 or 4. Yeah, management, most likely to be 4 tasks that are set. 4 or 5. Okay. And it's very, very strictly time limited, as it would be at work. So your colleague said, I'm going off to a meeting. I've got to be in the boardroom in an hour's time. I need 15 minutes to review the briefing notes that you give me, so get me these in 45 minutes' time. And when you're doing the test itself, there's a clock in the top right-hand corner of the screen. It's counting down, and when it gets to zero, task is finished. It assumes that you've just sent the email. All right? Well, it's better than not sending it, isn't it? Yeah? Your boss is sitting there saying, it's better to have a partly completed email. So, I mean, this is one of the things that we need to think about, sort of practicing and preparing for. You know, what will you do? You know, do your dear boss, here's the briefing notes you want, hope the meeting goes well, and then start typing in the gap in between so that it looks like a completed email. You know, and again, there's been a few questions about completing this task. It's not a test of how quickly you can type. There's not going to be a task that expects, you know, sort of five sides within 45 minutes or an hour. Because, you know, if you were giving something to your boss that had that amount of detail, your boss would, can you tell me? You know, just give me it in easy words. So a lot of the time that you're doing, you're spending in the task is going to be thinking or planning, jotting ideas down, and trying to communicate them as briefly, succinctly, and straightforward as possible. All right? And, you know, it's something, it happens on the paper-based exams. It's going to happen on the computer-based exams. I can tell markers will be complaining about it. People write too much. They start writing, and they don't stop. Then they have an idea, right? And this is where a computer's going to help. They have an idea, and they think it's a really good idea, but it's on page 3 of their answer. So they write it in block capitals, and then they go over it with thick ink so that the marker can see it. At least you'll have the copy and paste function within the case study that you can put your best idea at the top. You can edit out, you know, bits that you think are superfluous and so on. Okay, so it's not a test of word processing, is not a test of Excel. We're not going to be setting tasks that involve lengthy calculate. There'll be no requirements specifically for a calculation. There might be some numbers that you think it's useful to use. So I talked about the jet fuel prices. You might think it's useful to say, look, the average price increase or per month or per quarter has been 2%. But recent trends have it at 5%. You might think that's useful. I wouldn't have thought so with that question because you were given a graph that basically showed the problem. But you might think it's useful. But the examiner won't criticise, or the marker won't criticise if you include numbers that aren't asked for, and you won't be asked for any specific numbers in there. So there's no need for Excel skills. PowerPoint, not required in there. We're not putting any functions in for bullet points or tables or anything else that you might use if you were doing Microsoft Word or any other word processing, because we don't want to either reward people who work a lot with those just by chance or to disadvantage people who don't have exposure to that. Yeah, if you need to be good at written presentations for your work, you know, in terms of using colours and bullet points and all that, that's something for your CPD, really, or your professional development, your PER. Okay, so it's a very, very simple typing box. I did a session on Facebook on Friday, and somebody asked me about this. Oh, what about typing skills? And I said, well, you've just typed me a question, so clearly you can type. And there's very little more than typing in a text field for Facebook or, you know, comments that you write about a service you're feeding back on Amazon or something like that. No formatting or anything like that. So, That's really what that's intended to do, just to test how you can analyse the situation and communicate back, yeah, without extra award for being neat and tidy or whatever it is. Okay, it will be, you know, so it will be uploaded and sent through the cables and Wi-Fi or whatever to human beings somewhere in the world who will be marking it. All right, so there is an element of, you know, similarity to what we're doing just now. There will be, you know, a need for you to think about how you're presenting it. And the markers are going to be told, pretty much just put yourself in the role of the person who set the task. And just, what does this look like coming back? So you want clarity, you want prioritization, and all the things that we would say within any question that requires report writing just now. Okay, now, we've got, has anyone yet had a look at the practice test that we've put up? No? No hands in the air about that? Ask a question, yes.
About case studies. You said you've given some time to research the fictitious companies.
Yes.
Like, how long?
If I'm right, it's 7 weeks. We'll have the pre-scene material out 7 weeks before the first exam day in the exam window. All right? Which is about the same as we've got for T4B just now. I think T4B is 6 weeks before the exam. So we're going for 7 with this. All right? Good question. Yeah, for the case studies, past papers will be up, post-exam guides, and what we're investigating, and I think will happen, so I'll say it, and forgive me if it doesn't, we'll have an examiner's answer, but you know the examiner's answers for the paper, we call them the model answer, right? And again, from my perspective as a tutor, I always think that's unfair. You know, to say, well, here's a model. Here's what a model would do. Yeah, a model student, not Naomi Campbell or someone. Right? But it's that sort of perfection, and it's I've always found, you know, for students really disheartening because you don't know what a good pass would look like. So what we're hoping to do is get good student answers. So somebody who has gone through with a margin of safety and say, look, this answer is good enough to have passed. So we'll be doing that. I'll put this disclaimer up first. The practice tests, and I'll talk you through them in a moment and I'll show you where to find them. We've got practice tests available just now. They're really so that, you know, people are making decisions just now about the exams they're going to be doing in 2014. And obviously there's a bit of trepidation about the big changes for 2015. So what we want to do is make sure that people can see what the exams look like. Number one, just familiarity with what the technology is like. I don't know why they all jumped up at once. To see the variety of question styles that we've got, to see the complexity of questions. You know, so question, there's questions in there that will take 2 seconds to answer. You read it, you know the answer. There's questions that will require a bit of thought. There's questions that will require a bit of working. But what we're trying to do with each of the tests is there's going to be a range, a balance across the syllabus and a balance across the type of question, not just multiple answer, multiple choice, drag and drop, hotspot, etc., but the short and the long questions. All right? So you guys need to know that that's what it looks like before you make any decisions to, you know, you might think about holding off from doing exams in 2014 because you think it's multiple choice and you think it's easy. The other things that we've done, we're letting tutors have a look because they're busy developing questions. We're working with them on developing some of the questions and they're developing the materials. We know we won't get really good materials unless the publishers have had a good look at what the exams look like and can talk about it. So in order to meet our end of August, start of September publication date for this official material, we better let the publishers have a look at it. So that's what we've tried to do. And here's the health warning on this. If you do go into the exam and have a look at it and work for 90 minutes or complete the exam, come out of it, just ignore the score. For a couple of reasons. The questions that are in there haven't all been through the same rigour as real exams will have. So there's a couple of typos that have crept their way in and things like that. Nothing too bad. So it won't indicate to you whether or not you'd pass the real exam. Partly because you haven't studied the same syllabus. There's been a bit of movement and stuff from, you know, from F3 to P2, from P2 to P1, from E2 to E1, from P2 to P3. You know, there's things that are in different places. All right? So even if you have just taken and passed P1 and you went on to this system to look at the P1 test, you're not going to get the same score. It might be higher, might be lower, but it's not an indication in there. And one of the things that's going to be happening is that by October, so the final version, by October, what we're going to do is put the tests that are online just now, we're going to put them through Pearson VUE's full rigorous testing QA process so that come October, there is something in there that would be much more an indicator of likely performance, all right? But remembering that, you know, exam conditions and how much you've studied for it and so on. But it's something that going into 2015, I would be saying to students, if you take this exam, this is in 2015, if you take the practice test, having studied, and you score 30%, go back and study some more, right? If you take it and you score 90%, well done. I think you stand a good chance in the exam. All right? I'll only do advice in extremes. Okay. Now, a couple of things about this. Let me just go through this process. I won't do the whole thing, but I just need to point out a couple of things about it. On the CIMA Global website, you go into students, you go into 2015 syllabus, and it's got things saying practice exams, and you find yourself here. Hopefully this does stay with a good connection. There is some of the stuff that I've said in there about the exams and what we've done to create them. The bit that you're interested in is towards the bottom of the page. We've got a practice exam for every one of the 9 subjects and indicative practice case study exams. The case study exams are really just, you know, you're not going to get a mark from them. It's just there on the screen so you can go through it and see how a case study develops over time. The subjects, you can do. Now, I've just gone down to the bottom where it says what next. You might be interested. Now, remember, I did say at the start, Pearson VUE, we're still developing Pearson VUE test centres. There will be more test centres come 2015. But there's a little link at the bottom of the screen that you can click on it. You can put in, you know, Johannesburg. You can put down your postal code, zip code, whatever, and find out the nearest one to you. Yeah, 3.2 miles from my house to my nearest Pearson VUE test centre. 11.8 miles for our chief financial officer. Things like that. Now, the reason actually for going into this is just to give you a heads up. When you go in, you would think, right, there's a P1 practice exam. You'd think that this opens a P1 practice exam. It doesn't. It takes you into another page. It's all about P1. Tells you what's in there. Now, there's an exam tutorial. Every time you do a real exam, you will go through a tutorial that shows you how the screens are going to work. It's a compulsory 15 minutes tutorial at the start. I imagine by the time you're doing your 9th objective test, you don't want to spend 15 minutes going through that tutorial, but you have to. So, I don't know. Try and count, start singing 99 bottles of beer on the wall. See how far you get in 15 minutes. With the practice exam, I'll click on this in a minute, but the other stuff that we've got to go with the practice exam We've got general guidance notes that tell you a lot of the stuff that I've just talked about. I don't think there's anything of a surprise in there. Tables that you would get in each of the exam. All right, so if it involves discounted cash flow, there'll be the discount factors and there'll be a few formulae that you might have to use. Not in every exam. And then there's answers. And it is just the answer. There's no workings or anything like that. It's just the answer for the questions that's in there. Okay, now this is the bit to be aware of. When you click on, I just clicked on practice exam over there. It takes you off CIMA Global and puts you into Pearson View. And in order to host these practice exams, we've had to use Pearson View's secure site, which means you've got a lot of clicking to do. 13 clicks to get all your way through to the first page of the exam. That was a little bit too big. All right, now I've been through this a couple of times, but if you've not done this already, you're going to have to create an account. And I'll just show you some of the things that are involved in there, just to put your mind at rest when you're doing it, that nothing peculiar is happening. Because it's their secure centre, so secure it's not coming up. It's trying. But it takes you through what looks like a commercial site. All right, so you've got to agree to some policies, privacy policy, third parties and so on. Look, nothing. You are not going to end up getting spammed as a result of this. So believe me, I've registered about 5 times under different names, 3 different email addresses, one of which is not my own. This thing. Yes, my CIMA ID. This is not your CIMA ID. It's a CIMA practice exams ID. It's a new ID that will be created. So you can't just go through this. So I don't know my CIMA practice exam ID because I am brand new. So then we've got to go through this sort of stuff and try and think of a name that I've not used so far. I should make HRH, shouldn't I? There you go. I might as well do myself. Bear with me. Home, copy, paste. I don't know why they do that. Everyone shortcuts it, but... Alert! Oh, yes. I know there's one. Oh... So I've run out of emails that I could use, unless I use Charles Tilley, who's our chief executive. I'm not going to do that. Okay, trust me. When you go through that, it asks for things like your age, are you a student, how did you find us? It takes you through that, and I'm really sorry about it, but you've just got to stick with it and go through. All right, here she is. I bet this is, I've got the capital letters wrong, but... I'm so bad at remembering passwords and everything that's in there. Ah! Right. I saw it. Try this one again. If this doesn't work, then I'll just try and remember what the steps are. I'm not going to do it anymore. Okay, anyway, look, the story is you go through, and when I'd gone through here, I was then going to come out onto a landing page about the exams. And it's called something like a catalogue. So it looks very commercial. And you click on the exam you want. So I'd go on to P1, practice exam. Yes?
Log on with mine.
Oh, it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. We'll run out of time anyway. So I should know that anyway. Maybe I've been banned for taking too many and scoring too badly in them. But It talks about a catalogue. As you're going through it, it talks about an order process and your basket being filled and all this stuff. You know, again, just trust me, you stick with that and you go through and it will open the exam. You won't receive a bill. It doesn't ask for payment. It does give you an invoice, but that's the system, okay? And then when you're in there, you know, get a feel of the exam. For the OTs, you know, click through them. You know, it doesn't matter what you answer them. And like I say, you know, you'll get a score at the end if you go all the way through. And you get a feel for what that test is. And the main reason to be looking at it, as I say, is really if you are trying to make a choice as to what you're doing for the remainder of this year. If you're thinking about instead of doing something in November, you'll do something in January or February. Just make sure that that is an informed choice, having worked your way through there. I'm going to be in the hotel tonight working out what my passcode is. Yes?
You mentioned that now you're going with levels, so you need to finish level one
Yeah.
before you go to level two. I've got a friend who was writing operational papers now, and she passed two of her papers and failed one. So what do you think she does in this semester?
Passed two, failed one.
She passed F1 and E1, and failed P1. So she's thinking of doing the managerial level papers, because in this syllabus is
yeah.
And then she'll do the P1 paper next year.
I'm going to come on to that in a second. My advice would be, it depends. Right? And particularly, it depends on how close to getting a pass in P1. I'll come through to it in a second, right? I'll bear this in mind. Because now what I'm just going to talk about is that idea of people are currently in the qualification, they've done exams, they've failed or passed or got exemptions, and going on to 2015, what's happening to you. So, look, these are the principles, is that we don't want somebody to end up redoing an exam they've already done. You know, if you've passed F1, we're not going to make you redo F1 or ask you to do F1 over again. We don't want people having to take more exams or spend more times in exams. What you've got to realise, though, is that there's one sort of caveat to that, in that, you know, the P1 as it currently stands is a mixture of questions where you've got to get the numbers right and demonstrate your knowledge, and then they lead on to questions about discussion and interpretation and the sort of things that we're going to be testing in the case studies. All right? So that means that, you know, P1 itself, and this will be where your friend's going to have the choice, P1 itself, she might have done extremely well with the numbers, which meant that if she'd been in 2015 and doing it on the objective tests, she'd have passed. She might have struggled with the explanation part, which wouldn't have come up in the P1 in 2015. Right? So what we want to do is really make sure that everyone, you know, demonstrates the competence through the exams without having to do things over and over again. So if somebody has passed a paper, been exempted a paper, is a direct transfer over to the 2015 syllabus. If somebody has done three papers in a level, operational, they've completed operational level, they'll start 2015 at management. They won't have to do the operational case study. Okay? Because in doing those three subjects, papers, they've done explanation analysis and so on. They've not integrated it, but hey-ho, we're going to live with that. Okay, they'll do integrated stuff at management and at strategic. So, yeah, we'll make sure that people are competent with that. So that's the principles. I've got a few illustrations that will cover hopefully most cases. Somebody did catch me out on Facebook on Friday with a very peculiar one, but might get repeated here. But I doubt. So yeah, we'll look at position at end of 2014 in a couple of scenarios. What happens if you've completed a level? What happens if, like you're saying, you've got one paper to go or two papers? Yeah.
I think, Peter, one of the things that is a big factor for me was there's some exciting new things, such as this guy. And if I'm making a decision for next year and for November this year, it would be good for me to know at which level that comes in. So if I decide to go for the... because you mentioned something about... some of the data is moving around.
Yes.
So management is moving into operational. So let's say I'm finishing, my objective is to finish operational level this year. Am I not going to miss some of the data going on to management?
If you finish operational this year, no, because things like the big data is in E2 and E3. I mean, it's actually up the pillar. The change leadership is E2, E3. You know, so the new topics coming in are at management and strategic, and there are some people for whom that will be different. If somebody has taken and passed P2 in the 2010 syllabus, they'll go up to do F3 or strategic level, and they won't do complex discounted cash flow exercises because they've been moved down from F3 to P2. So. I don't know if that's good or bad. I love discounted cash flow, so I would be very upset. But, there are things. And there's not very many that are like that as big, chunky topics that are moved. So I think you'll probably be fine with that. Okay. So, I'll skip that last slide. So what I've said there by level is if you've got, right, so guys at operational level, if you get to the end of 2014 and you have, in one way or another, completed the three papers, I just pass, pass, exempt, it could be pass, 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 or exempt, 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 then when we get to 2015, we're saying that those three count for the full level, including the case study exam, okay? So if you complete in November your first case study exam, is going to be after you've done the three management. Yeah? So look, what's happening there is that you've still got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 syllabuses to learn, same volume of syllabus learning. You've got one extra exam, the case study. Okay? But on balance, you know, we're saying it's, and I could add up the minutes and say you've got fewer minutes of exam time. There's no, you know, extra discipline that you're having to do. Same volume of syllabus, same type of disciplines, just in slightly different scenarios. Okay? And the same would apply at management. Okay? Oh, I had done that. Look. There you go. Same syllabus volume, but 6 hours less of exams. Yay! The cost. I don't have the prices on my slides.
Because I think it would be fair for them to take into consideration, you know, that case study, how much are they going to structure the cost? Because for some people, it just look like it's the money scheming making business, because now there's extra module that you need to pay. So, especially if you can book any time, you can write four times or five times a year.
Yeah, it's not intended to do that. You saw the bit about ethics that I mentioned earlier. Yeah. We try to practice what we preach, and I do understand. But with the technology and the IT investment that we're making, I think the average exam cost is going up slightly. I couldn't tell you exactly what the percentage is. I can't remember off the top of my head, but I think that the paper-by-paper exams, I think I'm right in saying the costs are coming down. But then with the case study on top of it, yes, it is going to add to be more to complete a level. than we've got just now. But what we're very hopeful of, and I think particularly at strategic level, you know, the current arrangement for strategic level is that you have to do your three subjects together for the first attempt. Now, is anyone at strategic level? A few of you. Have you taken yet? Have you attempted yet? No? You don't, yeah. Well, most people that I ever taught at strategic level had a strategy, being strategic level, and that was to work really hard on two of the three papers and take, you know, for the third one, usually F3, usually my paper, just say, right, we'll can that one and I'll do that. So you're actually, a lot of people were planning to take four exams to pass the three, which we've done away with. So that the levels, the three papers are the same. You do one at a time, then the case study. Now, you know, I'm not saying that everyone, I don't think that's right. I don't think everyone should have been forced into doing that when a lot of people are, you know, I don't think people should have been planning to do that. You know, the studies should have been better or more supported or whatever. But it is one of the factors that's in there, is that I'm confident that pass rates will be higher with objective testing. Pass rates will be higher with objective testing. With the case study, yes, well, we don't have anything to compare it with, but I'd be hopeful, again, that there will be good pass rates on there. So, you know, so a lot of things on balance will work out. On average, I think the cost that a student pays to get through will be slightly lower. But, I mean, I do get your point. You know, and I say I can't sort of prove it, but you know, we've not set this project up in order to make more money for CIMA. I think actually CIMA is not going to be any better off, as we've got a very big IT project going on with a third party bringing a lot of expertise, which is quite costly. And yeah, I think see. If you see me driving around in an Aston Martin next time you're in London, then you can call me a liar. But yeah, that's not the aim at all. Okay, now just to try and give another couple of scenarios. So the level by level transfer is fine. Look, if you haven't completed a level when we get to the end of this year. Okay, strategic, there's no difference, because you would have been completing that paper in 2015 and taking T4B afterwards. The only thing is that when you go into 2015, you complete strategic using objective tests. You've got the flexibility of on-demand, so you might be able to complete slightly quicker or definitely at your own pace. So that's a little bit of a positive. With management, if you haven't completed management level, by the end of the year, then you're going to go into 2015 taking the remaining, you know, P2, E2, whatever. Then you have to take the management case study to wrap that together. So you will have one additional exam, the case study. Okay, we can count it up in terms of exam hours, but you've seen through that with the costs already. So look, they're just by picture. Like, take somebody who was exempt one, passed another at the end of 2014. The passes become credits, and I say we'll never take those away under any circumstance. So all that was outstanding was the enterprise management, which becomes project and relationship management, and then the case study to go forward. So that's sort of where that one goes. At the operational level, if the same applied, if you'd only taken and passed one exam, or were exempt one exam at the end of the year, you'd have to take, you know, your E1 and your F1, then you take your operational case study, then the four at management and the four at strategic, leaving with two additional exams. All right? There's one concession, and this comes back to your pal. So you said your pal had passed them both. So bear with me just a second. E1. Passed E1 and passed F1. E1. Yeah. So now, look, first illustration is if it is an exemption. right? This is just exactly the same slide with different names on it to the previous one. All right? If you haven't completed the level at the end of the year, you will have to, you will have to take the remaining subject and the case study. All right? It's exact same as management. So look, it's pretty important that you think about completing a level. And I know that there are some people who study up the pillar. They'll do, I should be looking one syllabus, but they'll do E1 and E2 together. Yeah? And then maybe F1 and F2 together. They might think about doing that. And in the past, CIMA have encouraged freedom of thought and planning around that. I would move away from that for this, because I don't want you to have to take a case study that just confirms that you can explain stuff, yeah, and analyse stuff that you've been doing in these subjects already. All right? So my advice would be complete the level, except for your friend. This is your friend now. If you've passed two papers, sorry, I didn't prepare the slide correctly. But if you've passed two papers, so you've under CIMA exam conditions, you've demonstrated knowledge, you've explained things, you've done a bit of communication with report writing and so on, then your friend has got an option to exercise a waiver over her P1, in my diagram E1. Which means that she doesn't have to take P1 in 2015. We'll effectively give her a credit, but she would have to take the operational case study. Okay, now this only applies. And it's just a concession, because otherwise you end up with two extra exams. One of them, the operational case study, really testing your competence in things that we've tested in our current methodology. Okay, not as well as we'd like to in the future, but we've done that. Okay, so there's regulations on this. Again, I think there's been words about it. Only operational level, only if you passed, so exemptions don't count for it, to the papers. Yeah? So you bypass that third subject and you move on, you take the case study. But you have to take that case study, operational case study, at one of the four exam windows in 2015. February, May, August, November.
So can she be smart and do managerial papers now?
Yeah. Right. She can be smart, do managerial papers now to progress. She'll have to come back and finish operational. Yeah. Yeah, she has to come back and do that. And I'll just give the advice here, is that I think 45% is a good enough score to say move on and do it. Because there's good knowledge in it. You don't get 45 by accident. There's good knowledge in there. Did some of you get 45 by accident? Yeah. There's not enough multi-choice and so on in there. So I'd say that there's the thing about exercising the waiver, if she hadn't attempted P1, she wouldn't know what half the words in the case study were referring to. She would if she moved on and took P2. But that's the point in there, is that the case study relies on familiarity with the three topics, like I said before, being able to pick out of the toolbox and get certain advice given based upon understanding at that level. Yeah.
Is the same option available on the managerial level?
Only operational.
What?
Only operational.
Managerial and operational. Now it's available.
To South Africa?
No. We come in. That is a question for Zara. Because I wrote my three managerial papers and I failed one. And I passed the other two. And so now I can't go to strategic because of this one paper.
Yeah.
So I sent an email to CIMA in the UK and I asked if they've got any exam venues in South Africa for September. Yes.
And what did they tell you? No.
They said no. Yeah. So I asked anywhere else in Africa, thinking Zimbabwe, given just across the border, it's not far.
I know, I'm going there next week. I hope it's not far.
They said no, it's only in the UK, it's only for strategic and T4. And then last week, I went to the site.
Nah, because it's also for, it's there are retake papers.
Now, if you go online, you'll see that it's changed, that they are research in September for managerial and operational.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's it's been that for a while. It's not just changed over this week.
I only noticed it last week when
No, it's been
there.
Applied
to me regarding the first
email. Yeah. No, it's been there for a while. There's been extra diets March and September. 2 years, 3 years. I'm really bad with time, but it's been there for a while. But we'll see about that, yeah. Zara's going to take a look at that, yeah.
Thank you for bringing Peter here. It's very exciting. But the question is CIMA South Africa doing anything to afford South African students to sit in these exams? It's the March and the September ones.
Well, yeah, next year you can take them. Why don't you come back to London? Register for it in London. Look, the question has been asked. It was actually asked by somebody in one of our other regions as well, just on Friday, I think it was. Somebody, there you go, deal with that. I don't know what the response is on there, but yeah, it's been raised as to whether that is possible, because you know, from 2015, or 31st December 2014, or November 2015, there are no retakes under the current syllabus. And if you have attempted a subject under the current syllabus, you've got one chance left to take on that. So if you're carrying, you know, P2 or whatever, you've got that one attempt in November for that. I say I'm not sure whether the practicalities will allow a September extra diet to happen. As you know, a lot would have to be arranged. Zara would have to find exam halls and things like that. But you know, it's something. I say it was asked on Friday. The director of exams got back from his holiday today. Will have escalated it. I've not seen any responses other than what's happening. So if something does happen, then we'll get that happening quickly. But I won't promise anything there.
Yeah, one more thing on that one. We actually did the calculations on how much it would actually cost me to go and do it in the UK.
Did you?
Yes.
And?
You need like 15,000.
What?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm thinking a different currency. My car didn't even cost £15,000. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if... I think we'll have to take it offline. And say I really can't promise anything because, you know, I wasn't in CIMA when they started the extra diets. I don't know what the rationale was, why they were available UK, nowhere else, or anything like that. And it is, yeah. Okay. Right. I've got a few questions around. I know we're sort of getting close to the end of time.
Yeah, sorry. I just need to find out. I haven't heard you talking a lot about T4. How much of
T4's gone. T4's gone. T4 becomes the strategic case study.
But is there any change in the structure?
Completely. T4B, you get a 20-page pre-seen material. Strategic case study, you'll get about a page pre-seen material. There'll be additional resource for research. T4B, you sit down at the start of 3 hours and you've got all the requirements in front of you and you can manage your 3 hours doing whatever you want with those requirements. Strategic case study, you get one requirement at a time based on the trigger and the task, so you do them one after. So currently under T4B, you could spend 2 hours doing half of the exam, or 2.5 hours doing half of the exam and try to pass the other half in half an hour. You can't do that under the case study because you'll have three tasks with 1 hour each, or four of 45 minutes each, or something like that. Very different. So again, if you can log on to Pearson View through our site and have a look at that case study, you'll see big, big difference.
But is the Excel or Word still exist?
No Excel, no Word, just the text box with a little bit of cut paste. I can't even remember if there's bold and italics in it. No bullet points, no nothing.
So if you pass strategic in the November exam, what happens?
If you pass the three strategic papers, or the third of the strategic papers, in November, then in 2015 you'll take the strategic case study, the replacement for T4B. I'm going clockwise. Can I write, sorry? Yes. Yeah, so if you've passed in November the last of your strategic E3, P3, F3, then in February, or I think actually we're doing it a week later, I think it'll be the first week of March, you can take the strategic case study on computer, and that's instead of doing T4B. So it's nearly there. It doesn't have a spell check feature. So just be careful. Yeah. Look, what we've got just now doesn't have a spell check feature, so it's got a handwriting check feature, but not spell check, no. Nah, so sorry about that. That would be a useful one, I think. I think it's fair. But given how many times I write to my manger about something, then that's, yeah. Words should be banned.
Two questions. So will every student get a different progress test, objective test? So our objective test will never be the same?
Yes.
Okay. So second question is, I think at the end we all have to make decisions on how we're going to tackle this year next year. So my decision is that I want to tackle my strategic next year, not during November.
Right.
Reasons, thinking that doing E3, P3 next year to sort of prepare me for the case study.
Yeah.
So, what are you doing?
It's the toughest choice that I would have in here. So the question is, should you do three strategic papers in November or should you wait until January? Do one in January, one 3 weeks later, or something like that, and then move on to the case study. You could do it in March. So if you didn't pass the papers in November, you'd be able to take the strategic case study in March, so there's no effect on time. So it's a matter of choice of the exam platform, the exam technique. Reasons for paper-based, we've got past papers as long as your arm. We've got all the extra diets, we've got going, but I think we've got about 16 past papers to practice from, and you can get really familiar with the technique of them in there. But then, you know, each exam diet is unique questions, so there might be something thrown into as a spanner in the works. Reason for doing the OTs is the one at a time, which, you know, is quite a strong argument to do that. As I say, I don't have a set answer on it. For me, it's almost a toss of a coin.
But it's not a bad game plan.
No, I'm not saying don't do it. I'm saying you choose. buck the trend. So I know we're passing. I appreciate people have got places to go and people to see, but I'll just carry on clockwise. And the content is different. Yeah. So look, you could start studying now for the November ones, and there's plenty of material and books and online tutorials and all that are going on now. The official study text will be available, I think, at the start of September. So you've got a little bit of a wait before you can start studying, but then you can study on past November, Christmas, January. Yeah. So again, you know, it really is. I have no strong advice on one. I think, I don't know. I keep on changing my mind what I think I would do. I've got to say, I would go for the OTs, don't I? Because they're brand new and they're brilliant, and we spent ages and millions in developing them. So we'd see. I would advise that you did that. Just simply, you know, when you get the textbooks, they've got everything in them that you need. If you had the current textbooks, take for F3 for example, 25% of the current F3 is capital investment appraisal, which isn't there anymore. So you'd need to find the stuff that is coming in to replace it, which then has you either looking around to try and find stuff or else buying another F3 text. And you know, the other two paper haven't changed by as much, but there are changes and it might be more infuriating. At least 25%, it hits you in the face, you know that's not there. But if it's a 5% here and an 8% there, then it's where. Any more questions around here? Yes. Then the case study, yes. Well, you're not. Remember, the question is, are you repeating the other two that you've already passed? You're not repeating them as such, because the case study doesn't. Let's think about F2, where you've got consolidated financial statements. You will never have to write consolidated financial statements in the case study. You might have them as evidence in the result of somebody doing consolidated financial statements as evidence that's looking at the state of the business. So you might comment on increases in this or decreases in that, but you won't be doing the test of F2 again. So you'll be applying your knowledge from F2. And it would be useful, you know, just to flick back through a couple of past exam papers, but not to sit down and spend 30 hours revising F2 before the case study. You won't have to do that.
So you wouldn't have to buy new textbooks then?
No. No. No.
What about the new information that you have been actually done?
It's a fair point, yeah. So something like, you know, so if we take P2, which now contains capital investment appraisal, or 2015 contains capital investment appraisal. Again, you know, I wouldn't buy the text, but I would look, you know, maybe just for a couple of articles or whatever on capital investment appraisal, because you've done that at P1, and it just the stuff that's in P2 now has got tax and inflation, but on a fairly technical basis. Really, all you need to know is, for capital investment appraisal, if you've got a positive net present value, that's really good. If you've got a margin of safety, that's even better. That's the quickest capital investment appraisal lecture. I usually take 3 days to do that. But I wouldn't go and say, let's get the text because I'm doing the case study. If you're doing the subject, yes. If you're doing the case study, no. But have the syllabus document, go through what you're familiar with. If there's something you're not familiar with, we're going to have support material added to our website with, you know, subject by subject guidance and gap fillers and things like that. Okay, so in a minute.
Operational level, because of the information model, if you're planning to write this year but not completing the level, how would you advise? Just leave the exam and start with the 2015 next year? or can you write one and then
play
on?
Look, if you don't complete, the question is about completing operational level. If you don't complete operational level in November, and let's ignore the waiver option because that's messy, you're going to be taking more subjects next year and the case study. Right, so the case study is a given. So, you know, you could do one or two papers in November and just take it as a given. You're going to do another paper or subject next year and the case study. It's just, you know, if you accept that that's going to happen one way or another, there's no reason to do nothing in November because you might as well chip away, get something done in November, and then you've got a head start for the level when you come into 2015. Yeah? Getting towards the end.
What did you check? You mentioned that the pass for the objective test is now 70%.
Yes. Yes.
Now the integrated test?
Yes.
Is that also 70%?
No, it's got a 60% 60% pass mark on it. 60, it's the case study, so I didn't say that on the way through. 60% pass mark. We've not, there's an extra bit of communication yet to be confirmed on this. But, you know, for in the strategic one, just as an example, where the competency donut has got 25, 25, 25, it would look for a minimum score in each of those four competencies. So you couldn't just get by on technical, business and people skills without displaying any leadership skills. I don't know what that minimum is yet. That's where the brain boxes back in Chapter Street are dealing with Pearson View and working out what that minimum is. But it will be a mark of 60, and the marks will be awarded against specific tasks, and the tasks will be categorised as technical skills, business skills, leadership or people skills. Okay. Right. I've done my clockwork bit and I've gone way over time.
Are you changing the practical work experience requirement?
Yes.
When are you releasing that?
Oh, sometime soon. I think it's not my field. And I was in a lifelong learning committee discussion of members and council when they were talking about it, but it brewed up to a bit of a fight, so I did the P1 practice test instead. If I remember correctly, those of you already in the system are unlikely to be affected by the change, and the change is largely to do with the administration of it, and it's going to much more online submission and so on and recording, and they're trying to just kind of map out the requirements of your practical experience to the competency framework. So there'll be, by and large, it will not make a big difference to what you have to do, slight difference to how you record it.
So still 3 years, still one.
Yes. Yes.
And then finally, are you still releasing the November results mid-January?
No! No, mid-December.
Wow, they're going to come out.
Before Christmas. What do you think of this?
That's awesome. That's great.
Now, what do you think of the 23rd of December?
No.
If I could, I'd show you. Do any of you subscribe to PQ Magazine? PQ Magazine, part qualified. It's available online, pqaccountant.com. It's a great little magazine that does stuff for students. And they found out that we were talking about getting them out before Christmas. And we said, definitely by the 23rd. So he's got a photograph of the Grinch, but superimposed Noel Tago's face on it. So instead of Jim Carrey as the Grinch, it's Noel Tago. But we'll have them out absolute latest on the 23rd. So that people have the we'll try to pull it back and bring in more resource to do the marking.
Now, in terms of the syllabus, operational, do you say like there's much change? Just emphasize on the managerial and
the teaching
that
I do have slides somewhere that show where all the ins and outs are. I think we have got something on cimaglobal.com that's got the changes summarized. Every paper has got some change, but some of it's that, some of it's 25%, as I mentioned a moment ago. Okay? Right, last question. Promise you.
Will the new syllabus be incorporated for the November 2014 exam?
No.
And also, so the past marks for the November
2014? No, November 2014 is under the 2010 syllabus, 3 hours in a paper, 50% pass mark. Any 50 marks will do. That's how it goes. All right, thank you very much for coming. It's been super seeing you. So, run away.